Hello, hello, Mordimers here, and welcome to semifinals of Lindores Abbey Rapid Challenge 2020. We had two semifinals, so in one of them, Daniel Dubov played against Ding Liren, and in the second one, Magnus Carlsen against Hikaru Nakamura, and I will show you all the scores after this video, but I would like to first show you the one of the games, in my opinion, the most interesting game. So Magnus Carlsen, his Rapid ranking 2881, number one in the world, and also triple world champion in Rapid, Blitz, and Standard Time Control. And he's gonna play as black. And his opponent, Hikaru Nakamura, he's ranking 2829. This is his Rapid ranking. And he's gonna play as white. So without further ado, let's see what happened on the board. We have e4 by Hikaru Nakamura, e5, knight on f3, knight on c6, bishop b5, Rui Lopez on the board. And here a6 can be played by Magnus, but he prefers Berlin defense, so we have knight on f6. And I will just show you one of the main lines where white castle and black takes the pawn on e4. This is the main line here. And after d4, opening all the position, knight d6 attacking the bishop, and after exchanging d takes on e5, knight have to be moved, queens exchange, and this position was played and reached many times, thousands of times, even on the top levels. And it's pretty okay, pretty solid for black. Even black cannot castle, but it's not so easy, you know, to win as white. However, Hikaru Nakamura prefers the more solid line, and he plays d3. And okay, that is everything is normal. Now we have bishop on c5, taking under control d4. So now, for example, knight can jump to d4 with the attack on the bishop. This is why here c3 can be played, with the idea of kicking the bishop, and then the bishop can hide on c2. Or also, what is possible is bishop takes on c6, and this is what Hikaru Nakamura played. We have d takes on c6, and here important information, if you ever played it, knight cannot take this pawn, because if the pawn is taken, queen d4 wins the game, because attacks the knight and also threatening the checkmate. So white gonna lose the minor piece and of course the game. So instead, of course, Hikaru Nakamura knows the theory, play knight b on d2. And now Magnus Carlsen could go for the castle, but he takes a very side line and play bishop on g4. We have h3, bishop on h5, and here knight on c4 is the main idea in the Rui Lopez, but also in this variation of the opening, attacking e5. And e5 cannot be defended quite easily. Usually is defended by knight on d7 and then f6, and that's the idea. But Hikaru choose to play a3. So this is quite new, at least on the top level it wasn't played yet. And Magnus continue his normal way of development. So knight on d7, followed by f6, and then knight can jump to f8 and, you know, play, for example, this way. We have g4 by Nakamura, so kicking the bishop. We have bishop on g6, and now b4, kicking another bishop. So as you see, bishops have to retreat, this time to d6, and Hikaru got a lot of space for his pieces now. So that's definitely his advantage, but he cannot, you know, move his pawns back. So this is the disadvantage. So now the idea for black is to regroup and then just, you know, attack the pieces of black. And whose idea gonna be better? Then, of course, gonna win the game. So we have knight on c4, very typical for Rui Lopez, also attacking the bishop, but Magnus Carlsen doesn't really care, because he gonna just, you know, fix the pawn structure. And also in the closed position like this one, knights are much better than the bishop. So that is the idea, not to exchange these pieces. We have f6, creating this very strong pawn chain, and it's not really weakened the position of the king, as white doesn't have the light square bishop to actually attack the position of the king, if black want to, for example, castle on the king side. And here Hikaru starts to jump with his knights, He's flanking his opponents, let's say, with his cavalry, and he play knight on a5, attacking b7 and also attacking c6, just in case if the pawn on b7 gonna move. That's, it's not really possible because black gonna lose the pawn. So we have queen on c8 defending, and now knight on h4. So look at this, both knights, you know, flanking all the army. But it doesn't work the same way in chess. So this knight just going to f5. It's not just, because this is beautiful outpost for the knight. From there, the knight can control d4, so prepare d4. Also can keep an eye on the bishop and attack if it's needed. And also can keep an eye on king's position. So definitely very well placed knight over here. And Magnus Carlsen also want to improve the position of his pieces, so definitely the knight going first. We have knight on f8, knight on f5 as planned, and now knight on e6 also as planned. And now this knight can jump and to other squares, maybe not for now, but it's very, very well placed knight. We have bishop on e3, so developing the bishop, and now king on f7. Magnus could go for the castle straight away, but he preferred to move the king to f7, then bring the rook, and then king maybe can stay in the center, maybe can go back to g8, up to the position. And here we have c3. So Hikaru Nakamura actually built the bathtub formation, and he likes to do it. He played that a lot in some blitzes. However, in this position, a d3 pawn doesn't have any support now, and it's gonna become the weakness, which can be not easy to defend in the future and can be a problem. We have rook on e8 by Magnus Carlsen, and now h4, so attacking on the king side. And now, of course, the bishop is in danger as h5 is coming, so king have to retreat to g8. So we have king on g8, h5, bishop on f7, and here d4 was possible already. So Hikaru could strike in the center, but he has a different plan. He plays queen on f3. Queen on f3 with, you know, idea of supporting the pieces on the king side, and also supporting the pawns. And you will see the way how he gonna do. And this is probably critical moment of the game, because Magnus Carlsen has to react. Otherwise, you know, moves like queen on g3 and g5, maybe h6 are coming and can be very, very annoying and dangerous for the position of the king. So Magnus play b6. He counter attack on the queen side. And now what to do with this knight? If the knight takes on c6, the game gonna be extremely complicated, and I doubt that the players could, you know, see all the consequences what would happen, because after queen on d7, the knight is trapped. So the only move would be b5, defending, and now a6. And of course, a4 is not possible, because the rook is hanging on a1, and c4 also is not really great, because then after exchanging, a3 pawn is hanging. So not this way, but rather d4. Very, very complicated continuations. Now, I'm not gonna show you all, but after e takes on d4, c takes on d4, a takes on b5, the knight is under attack. And now e5, believe me or not, e5 is the best idea here. And it's so complicated that I will just show you that d5 doesn't really work, because after knight on g5, you see already what's going on. This rook is on the same file with the king, and king didn't castle yet. So after bishop on g5, bishop d5 can be played, and now the pawn is under attack, cannot be really defended. The bishop is under attack, the knight is under attack, this pawn is also under attack twice. So if the queen moves somewhere, then it also can be taken. A lot of ideas here, and most important, this pawn is pinned, so white have to react somehow. So very, very complicated game. This is why in this position Hikaru Nakamura didn't decide to take on c6, and he just retreat. However, very interesting thing could happen if Hikaru goes for h6. Just insane move. And now if g6, for example, then knight can take on c6, and black doesn't need to worry about this knight, because if If black decide to take the knight, that's gonna be disaster with this, with the open g file. That's just gonna be disaster for them. So white would stand really great and would have very nice attack. Probably would take back the minor piece pretty soon back, and then get all this attack. So maybe not g6, and also b takes on a5 doesn't really work. H takes on g7 and also semi open file. This would be really really dangerous for black to play. So definitely that was the idea. And Magnus actually in the interview said that he was afraid of these moves like h6 coming anytime, or g5, you know, can come, and that's can be very very annoying. So in this position actually Hikaru goes for knight on c4, so more safe approach, and now attacking the bishop. Magnus want to keep that bishop, bishop f8, as this bishop, dark square bishop, is really strong defender of the king's position. We have castle by Nakamura now, so you know, h6 is not as dangerous as before with the rook on h1, but at the same time the king is in the safety, okay, because in the center it could escalate very very quickly with the rook on the e file. I already show you one of the variations, so definitely it's better to move the king to the safety. Hikaru lost first game, so this is the second game, and he definitely didn't want to lose this one. So better not to risk, just, you know, win in better idea, with the better ideas. We have a5 by Magnus, so he counter attack in the queen side, and Hikaru doesn't really care here. Queen on g3, so moving the queen now on the same file with the king. And now all of these ideas, g5 and h6, seems to be pretty dangerous, especially with the knight, which can jump to h6 in the future. The bishop also can sacrifice on h6. So black have to be very careful here and play quite precisely. First we have a takes on b4, and now a takes on b4 would be very very natural. However, we have c takes on b4 by Hikaru Nakamura. So interesting. Maybe a3 and d3 weaknesses are gonna work as a bites in Hikaru's plans. I'm not really sure. And he want to attack on the king side. However, Magnus have different idea here, and he said h6, I'm gonna block the king sides, no more, you know, g5, no more h6. So h6, and I'm closing the king side. So let's play in the center on the queen side, and let's see who gonna be better over there. So we have rook f on d1, now supporting the pawn. Definitely this is a weakness, so Hikaru want to push the pawn. We have b5 attacking the knight, so knight have to retreat. Knight on d2, now blocking the rook from supporting the pawn, and here c5, so Magnus want to exchange the pawns on the c file, as he has a double pawns, and Hikaru agrees with that. So b takes on c5, and now bishop takes on c5, bishop takes on c5, knight takes on c5, and in this exact moment Magnus just thought, I just missed some tactic. I just missed that. Rook A on C1 follow with the knight on D6. Okay? You see that already? Maybe it will take for a while, you know, to recognize that there are some tactics here, because in studio also all the commentators, grandmaster, missed that. And Magnus in last moment thought, okay, but still, I can actually play knight on E6. If I play knight on e6, it should be fine, because knight d6, and I can take that knight, exchange the queen. You see already what is going on. That was quite, you know, coming out of nowhere. And Magnus in the last moment just calculated, okay, I'm fine here, and I'm much better here. Because look at the white pieces. White pieces, this queen is nowhere. The knight and the rook also not coordinated at all, and black at the same time attacking the pawn on a3. Another rook can come support this attack. The knight can jump to beautiful d4 square. Also this bishop supports the march of the pawn. So very clear idea, but Magnus said it's not as clear as what's happened in the game. And here Hikaru play knight on f3. So definitely he is just preparing d4. So he want to push d4. We have queen on d7, and now d4 is not really prepared yet, because after d4, knight can jump to e4 with attack on the queen. Queen has to move, and now just black, you know, win the pawn and gonna have very, very comfortable game. So what Hikaru did, he first improved the position of his king. I know the position looks like, you know, really, really bad for him, because a queen and the knight attacks on d3. However, a king on h2 not only improves the position of the king, but also set up a little trap. But this, you know, it's trap for the beginner. So whenever you want to take the pawn like this, always look if the rook not watching on your queen or on your king. It's very, very common idea, and you know, traps, really traps for beginner. And in this position, actually knight on e1 with the triple attack on the knight. So here is the problem. So even if you support the knight with the bishop, is not enough. Black gonna lose the piece and of course the game. So after king on h2, of course Magnus didn't take that and just play bishop on e6. Now keeping an eye on the knight, and this knight is pretty annoying, you know, on this position. So it's better just to eliminate the knight when the time is right. And here Hikaru actually play very, very sneaky move. Rook a on c1. And how sneaky is that? Knight on b3 is the obvious answer by Magnus. He played that. He not only attacks the rook, but also controls a1. So rook cannot, of course, defend the pawn, but it doesn't really matter. It's not the idea of Hikaru. He play rook on c3. We have rook on a3. And now d4. Now d4, pretty sneaky. And the idea is, e takes on d4, this pawn cannot be taken, okay? Because if the pawn is taken, then we're gonna have rook c7 with attack on the queen. And white is winning here. Black gonna lose the queen. Queen is actually trapped. And if queen moves, for example, to d8 is the only move, because all other squares are controlled. So that would be a trap. Rook g7, and white gonna checkmate the opponent. So for example, king on f8, and now another knight can come and mate from g6. So very, very sneaky. Even bishop on f7 doesn't really work, because the pawn gonna come to g6 and checkmate is still on the board. And if you try to, I don't know, you have to sacrifice the queen or the rook, maybe this way, but you know, it's losing. It's just, it's forced checkmate. Actually, the engine says in 10 moves, but if black just want to make some space, it doesn't work. I will just show you how the checkmate works here. To e8, then checkmate would be on g7 with the knight, very beautiful one. And if kings move to g7, then still knight h6, and we're gonna have a checkmate on h7. So a very, very sneaky idea, d4. Also, knight on d4 is not possible to play now, because the rook is hanging. So quite clever idea. However, Magnus found the way, you know, how to stop that. So feel free to pause the video and find the winning move. There are at least two moves for Magnus Carlsen, while I enjoy my cup of tea. Okay, ready? So the move recommended by the engine, but more risky one, is c5. With the idea, if white gonna, you know, create the passed pawn, protected passed pawn, then black gonna have two passed pawns, okay? And two passed pawns, of course, are better than one passed pawn. That's obviously true. So that was the first idea, but Magnus go for more secure way. And first he play b4. Attacking the rook, so this is move with tempo, but also defending the rook. And here is the, this is the most important, because now after rook c on d3, knight can very safely take the pawn on d4. So there are no more tricks on c7. And yeah, this is just exchange. So we have knight from the third rank to d4. We have e takes on d4. And now not rook takes on d4, because if rook takes on d4, we would have queen d4, okay? And after rook d4, rook on g3, king on g3, c5, and these two connected these two connected passed pawns, of course, winning the game with support of the bishop, with support of the rook. This is, you know, just winning. Also, a knight on d4 is also not possible because rook on d3, and after rook on d3, bishop on c4. If queen takes, then bishop can takes on g4, so bishop on c4, and if rook d2, rook e4, winning this pawn, and still with two connected passed pawn is winning for black. The queens are still on the board, but it doesn't really matter. It's much better position for black. So Hikaru Nakamura plays absolutely the best move here. Rook on a3. We have, of course, b takes on a3, and now rook on d4, attacking the queen. The rook is, of course, protected by the knight. So very nice coordination of the pieces. And now Magnus has to find the only winning move in the position. And it's amazing. He just found it almost immediately. It's very, very simple idea. Queen on b5, and now queen b2, and this pawn just promoting, and that's all. The problem is white can choose, you know, to take one of these pawns, but which one to take? If actually queen takes on a3, which is more obvious and actually better move, it's still not easy to continue the game. I mean, the material is equal, but black gonna win in the end game, because after bishop takes on f5, the pawns of course cannot take, because queen e5 attacks the rook with check, so would win the exchange and of course the game. So rook on d5 first, and after queen on c4, g takes on f5, queen actually can take on e4, could take on g4 if another pawn takes or the rook takes, so doesn't really matter. And this position is much better for black. It's only one pawn up, but this pawn structure is terrible. King is, you know, in the open area, and this king, black king, is very, very safe. So black would just, you know, deliver probably a checkmate, or maybe just, you know, pick up more pawns and just win the game. So it's definitely very difficult to decide to play these endings. So Hikaru tries different way, and he play queen on c7, threatening the checkmate. So the threat is a... it's a very, very serious, however, it can be defended very easily. Bishop f5, just eliminate the knight. So as you see, moving the bishop and keeping an eye on this knight was very, very important. And after e takes on f5, we have queen on b2. So the plan works, and of course, nothing can stop the pawn from advancing and winning the game. Hikaru Nakamura try last trick, so we have queen on c4 with check, king h8, and as the pawn on f2 is under attack and is undefended, so we have king on g3, a2, and here Hikaru goes for queen on a4, simply attacking the rook. And if you have a couple of seconds on the clock, you can miss it and, for example, promote. That would be a disaster, because queen on e8, of course, winning the game. That would be just a checkmate. So that would be a very, very hilarious end by Magnus Carlsen. But of course, he is the world champion for the reason. And he found absolutely wonderful endings. Queen on b8 with check. And in this position, Hikaru Nakamura resigned the game, as he can do nothing. Black just gonna promote the pawn. So if king on h3, queen a8, very, very simple idea, and nothing can be done, okay? The pawn gonna promote in the next move. Even if queen on a8, that just doesn't matter, because it's gonna promote anyway. And black gonna win the game. So that's being said, and I would like to show you what happened in the semi-final. So this is the first mini match of the both of the pairings. So Hikaru Nakamura against Magnus Carlsen. As you see, Magnus Carlsen crushed Hikaru Nakamura 3-0. So he shows who is the boss, and really incredible. Hikaru Nakamura didn't have even a little chances. Magnus Carlsen controlled all three games, so no doubt that he is the world champion, number one player in the world. And we have some surprise. Daniel Dubov actually won one game against Ding Liren, then Ding Liren won, and then we had a draw, and in the fourth game Daniil Dubov managed to win the game. Ding Liren got some weak moves. He was thinking probably about Armageddon, as he got the better position after the first round, so he could choose the color in Armageddon, but that's where Daniil Dubov striked, and he won the fourth encounter. So we have 1-0 for Daniil Dubov, and if Ding Liren wants to stay in the tournament, he has to win another two mini matches. So quite a surprise, but we're gonna have more interesting games, and if you don't want to miss them, of course, press subscribe, smash the bell button. Thanks for watching, and see you in the next one.